Whether you're looking for answers to specific life questions or seeking to become the best version of you possible, welcome to the Mental Breakdown and Psych Reg podcast, where we offer insight, information, and strategies based upon research and years of practice as clinical psychologists. So sit back, have a listen, and get connected with our hosts, Dr. Bernie Wilkinson and Dr. Richard Marshall. Welcome back. Richard, today we're going to wrap up this week talking about a topic that sort of wraps up the last couple weeks of things that we've talked about.
Yeah, we've been talking about this for most of this week and a little
bit. What's funny is people watching it on YouTube can see that you're looking at something.
Off into space.
But they're like, what's he looking at? Is he...
I'm looking at my cue cards.
Is it... That's right.
Yeah. Hey, we look nice today. Look at these ties. Look at this, how we go together. What is the significance of yours and mine?
Mine would be Chelsea, but yours is Orlando City Purple.
That's right.
We're representing soccer teams today.
You say soccer.
Well, I said soccer for your benefit. Homage.
No, I like these colors.
Yeah.
You got a nice white shirt.
That's right. Okay. I think this is the first time we've worn the same color shirt.
Might be. Well, you have those. You have that array of brightly colored. You know, you're kind of... We kind of think of you as a peacock. With all those bright colors coming out. And I'm just sort of a drab...
Crow.
A black crow. Not even a black, just a drab crow. Anyway.
That's right.
Yes, this is a continuation of some...
some of the topics we've talked about.
And topics. That's what word I was looking for, was topics that we've been discussing. But this is a real nice article that sort of helps to pull all of this together and organize our thinking. So pay close attention. There's a couple of really good, there's some really good advice in this, not necessarily ours, but we're gonna pass it on to you.
Right, yeah. In this article, it's written by a psychologist, mm-hmm. Joel Minden. And he talks about overcoming negative thinking with a very targeted action.
That's right. And Dr. Minden has a CBT practice out in California. So he's not a critic of anybody. In fact, he does cognitive mm-hmm. behavioral therapy professionally in his practice. It's called CBT something or other.
Yeah.
So he has a website and a practice that specializes in CBT. So I say that because we're not being critical of anybody or any approach. But I think the information he imparts in this article will be of value to listeners.
Yeah. Well, and the way that it ties in with some of the things we've talked about before is that, you know, over the past couple of weeks, we've talked at length mm-hmm. about, you know, when there are issues with depression and anxiety, mm-hmm. there are particular things that we tend to do as mm-hmm. psychologists or as counselors, as therapists, what we try to help the person change their thought patterns. We help them challenge some of those cognitive distortions and really reconsider the way in which they're thinking about mm-hmm. themselves and their life in general.
Right.
And that's a very cognitive behavioral approach.
That's right. Because after Skinner developed this whole behavioral approach to things, mm-hmm, then mm-hmm. Many of his students went on to say, well, wait a minute, maybe if we change our thinking, mm-hmm. we can also change our behavior.
Right.
Not just because we're reinforced for it,
right.
punished for it, but just if we change our thinking, can we change our behavior?
Yeah.
So that was the birth of this whole cognitive behavioral approach behavior change.
And so some very well-known people in the realm of cognitive psychology, mm-hmm. like Aaron Beck and Martin Seligman, you know, these guys have really... work to forge a path through this maze of what happens in our mind when we're thinking about things.
That's right. They've devoted a lifetime
to
developing these approaches and strategies that mm-hmm. people can use.
Yeah. yeah. Mm-hmm. So from that came cognitive behavioral therapy and it's probably one of the more common forms of therapy, mm-hmm. Talk therapy anyways.
Right.
What we're starting to see, I think, are some of the limitations with it.
That's right. And we do with all these approaches.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
oh, yeah, there's limitations of all of them.
Not every approach works with everybody.
Right.
And in our practice, we obviously are an eclectic approach. We use an eclectic approach because we use whichever theoretical perspective we need.
with that particular family or patient.
Rather than putting everybody through a single perspective. There are limitations with all of these approaches. And mm-hmm. that's what I meant during the introductory comments, that we don't mean to be critical.
Right.
But there are limitations with all of these approaches.
Right.
Doesn't matter which one you use.
Right. And as we talked about a couple weeks ago, the concern really with cognitive behavioral therapy that we're seeing
right.
is that there is so much information mm-hmm. and there are so many other techniques and self-help books and all that work from exactly that same perspective
right.
that many people begin to dismiss it from the outset. Mm-hmm. I mean, as soon as you say, okay, let's talk about how you're thinking about things. I say, oh, I've done that before.
Right.
Doesn't work.
That's right.
We're going to have to do something different. We need cognitive behavioral therapy. And we say, well, that is cognitive behavioral therapy.
Right.
And they say, oh, no, because that's, self-help book stuff. I need, real cognitive behavioral therapy.
Right.
And then you say, well, that is real cognitive behavioral therapy.
Right.
Because the goal is to change thinking.
That's
change
right.
the way that you think and to change the way that you behave.
That's right. And it's made its way into the internet so people can read about it. And I think of time out. People say, no, I've tried time out. And it's well, you've tried a version of time out, but let's try the, and it's same with cognitive behavioral therapy. So
time out is a great example that it's so interesting talking to people about the use of time out. Well, time out doesn't work. Well, where do you put him in time out? In his room. I make him close his door and he has to stay in his room. What's in his room? Everything.
And TV, the aquarium.
TV, video games, everything. Yeah. So he just has to sit in there and think about what he did wrong.
Right.
I'm sure that's what he's thinking about in his room.
I don't think so.
So.
But the problem with that we're going to talk about this morning with CBT is that even if it's used well, mm-hmm. it isn't always effective.
Right.
That we run into situations mm-hmm. where cognitive behavioral therapy isn't effective.
Because
there's anything wrong with CBT,
right?
Okay.
Let's jump into the six reasons.
Six
reasons
right.
why mm-hmm. There are times that it's more challenging to use cognitive behavioral therapy.
That's right. Why it's not working. It's not because there's anything wrong with it. Mm-hmm. It's just you're going to run into these six obstacles.
Right.
The first one is
time.
That's right.
It takes a lot of time. It
takes time. Right.
Not just to identify.
That's right.
What the negative thinking is, to kind of differentiate negative mm-hmm. thinking from reality.
Right.
Sometimes the negative thoughts that we have are based in reality. They're not distortions.
Yeah,
they are real life. Mm-hmm. I mean,
right.
bad things happen to us sometimes in real life. And so we have to acknowledge that and differentiate that negative thinking, the patterns of negative mm-hmm. thinking from other things. So time is a massive issue.
Right. And the thing about cognitive behavioral therapy is it takes practice to get it right. And, mm-hmm. and you have to work at it for a while. And frequently people are under such stress or they're so distressed that they simply don't have the time to use the approach.
Right.
The approach works. It's just that there's so much distress that we simply don't have time to use the technique.
Absolutely. And, in this day and age, and I know that we've mentioned this before, but in this day and age, we are in need of immediate gratification.
Right.
We don't want to work.
No, and we want immediate intervention.
Right. Mm-hmm. So we want our needs to be satisfied immediately.
Right.
And so, when you say, okay, well, cognitive behavioral therapy works, like with depression, mm-hmm. I remember presenting to my students, okay, so with cognitive behavioral therapy, you can do that with depression, and symptoms usually mm-hmm. remit within the first 16 sessions.
Right.
I think 16 sessions, that's 4 months.
At least, at the very least, 4 months.
Right.
If you meet every other week, it's, I mean.
Yeah.
Yes,
if you meet every other week, it's 8 months.
Right.
And they think, oh my gosh, that's so long. But, medication mm-hmm.
takes time.
4 to 6 weeks or so before even start seeing efficacy.
If you start with the right medication.
Right, and then you may have to change medications. So we're still looking at
months,
the
it's
same
4 months.
Amount of time
right,
for
right.
medication
right.
with some of these things.
Right.
But we have this idea that, okay, I got to do something right now.
Mm-hmm.
And taking a pill is doing something right now. So you at least feel like you're doing something even if there's no symptom relief.
Mm-hmm. And hence the placebo effect.
Right. Okay. Right.
So one is time.
So time is an issue.
The second one?
The next thing is, when there's lots of emotions, sometimes it's we become overwhelmed and we just forget to think about the fact that we're experiencing automatic thoughts.
Right.
And so sometimes the demands or the feelings overwhelm our ability to really process what's happening.
That's right. That's right. It's a, and they become
so
much a part of our life that it's sort of the, that's our default setting.
Right.
And you just go there very easily because you've been there so many times.
Right.
That's the easiest place to go.
Absolutely.
And if, and these, because they are intense, that's the direction you're always heading.
Yeah. Okay? Yeah. So, so it's really, you know, really a difficult thing for a lot of patients. And I was talking to a patient recently and, you know, she's trying some different things and she's even trying medication now, but her emotions sometimes overwhelm her so much that she just can't use the strategies that we're talking about.
They can't slow down. They can't collect their thoughts because the emotions are simply too intense.
Yeah, right? Absolutely.
So, so that's another place where it may be difficult to use.
It just overwhelms the, your cognitive ability to process.
And that's particularly
happening.
True with panic attacks, you know, where people they get overwhelmed and move to a panic attack very quickly. It just overwhelms everything else.
Panic attacks, OCD, is another another example.
Right.
So. Now, the third thing is that, you know, the reality, I'm going to keep saying the reality, because, you know, sometimes we talk about things outside of reality, like how idealized things are sometimes, not fantasy.
I was thinking Star Wars.
Ooh, that's a good thought.
Oh, you know, Harry Potter.
That's another good thought, but that's not what we're talking about here.
These are
real life
unpleasant thoughts.
Yes. And what the number three problem is that sometimes it's really difficult to think about these problems. Sometimes it really challenges your self-worth, your self-esteem, and really pushes you because it's uncomfortable.
Right. Well, there are two things about this third obstacle. One is that when we ask our patients to dig into these things, those are painful places to go frequently. The other thing is, we don't want them to go to the, you know, the object is to move away from that stuff that you find it. So, but you have to do that work there, okay? And in some cases, it's just too painful to go there. I had a young boy, not young boy, he was a teenager. And every time we would get anywhere close to that, it would spark an explosive outburst, you know. As soon as he got anywhere near those topics that was so very painful for him. So it just took a long time to be able to talk about this stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, a long time in terms of years, not weeks or months.
Yeah, so it's distressful. And we have to work really hard with our patients to make sure that they can handle those things, that they can really appreciate what's happening so that they can manage it and not fall into any abyss in between sessions.
And I'm sure you found this. There are some office visits where they can, and there are some office visits where they simply can't.
Right.
And you have to use your clinical judgment to say, okay, today's not a day to go there.
Yeah.
And you just have to spend your time doing other things.
Yeah, exactly.
Number four?
Number four is that sometimes instead of, what he writes is, instead of effectively restructuring a belief, it's possible to fall into the trap of replacing negative thoughts with equally inauthentic and frustrating positive thoughts.
Right.
And how many times have we heard that from our patients that, you know, there's a lot of the recommendations out there to fake it till you make it. And so you start filling your head with these, what we know are artificial thoughts about things. And while there is a place for that at times, if you're telling yourself things that you don't believe, it's not going to be very effective.
That's right. That's right.
Like, you know, for many people, we can wake up in the morning and we can say, today's going to be a great day, but we believe it. For people who are struggling with depression, they may wake up and say, today's going to be a great day. Yeah, right. Is the thought that comes in and they don't really, and they don't believe it. And so they see those positive thoughts as inauthentic.
That's right.
And so they don't believe them. And so it's not really helpful in any way.
The process won't work.
Right. So when you're working to fake it till you make it, there has to be some aspect of belief in there.
Therapists will say to you, well, you have to tell yourself this. You know? And so you say, well, no, this is going to be a great day, or I am really this or that. and you really don't believe that you are.
Right.
So in those cases, it's this process will also be ineffective.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because, you know, when you're not, when you're not really on board with it,
right,
it's just not going to be very effective.
That's why, like any technique, it's best in the hands of a real professional who knows how to use it, because it's easy to get it wrong.
Right. Yeah. So. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. So number five is that patterns, when we get into this pattern, this routine, this rut of negative thinking, sometimes we are in that rut for years, and that makes it very difficult to get out of those ruts.
Let's say you're seeing somebody who's 22 or 23 years old.
Mm-hmm.
If they've been doing the same thing for 10 or 12 years, that's not going to change quickly.
Right.
I mean, you have 15 or 16 years of patterning.
Right.
And when I say pattern, I think of the brain.
Right.
That the brain has been doing the same thing over and over and over and over and over again. Well, the brain gets very good at what it does over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And so your brain has gotten very good at doing this.
Right.
And there's much talk today about neuroplasticity, that we can change the brain. Oh yeah, you can change the brain, but it's not going to happen quickly.
Right.
I mean, if you spent 20 years doing, 10 years doing something, don't expect that to change in a couple of weeks.
Right. And in fact,
it doesn't change that fast.
You can spend 6 months and make the change and things can be going great. And then another 8 months later, after you've made the change, your brain will
bounce you back to where
Test it. It'll just test that old track see if it's going to be there still.
It's going to bounce back to where you were.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's elastic, and then it's going to move around of its own.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, and you know, this is really, when we're thinking about this, what we're really, one of the things that we're talking about is classical conditioning.
Right.
You know, I talk with patients often about patterns that they get into where if I hear this, if I'm in a relationship and that person says this, I automatically think that something bad's going to happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, you're trying to, I don't know why I think that way. I don't know what happens. And then as you get into it, you find out, well, in past relationships, that's happened. Right. And so when you pair one behavior that maybe even an inert or benign behavior, and you pair that with a negative trauma or a negative, not that there's a positive trauma, I suppose, but if you pair it with something really negative, and then what happens is you, like Pavlov demonstrated with his studies, though that wasn't really what he was studying, but we'll have to get into that. This isn't a lesson in Pavlovian classical conditioning, Richard.
Only one of us took us there.
But when we pair those negative experience or negative feelings with even benign stimuli, it becomes a very tight bond, and it's very difficult to separate.
To break it again, because you've done it over and over and over again,
and it happens on a positive way too.
That's right,
and because we have some sensory memories that are much stronger than others. So there are times when you can walk into a room and you can smell something that will immediately take you back to 50 years ago. I said 50 years ago for your benefit, because 50 years ago, I don't remember anything from 50 years ago.
You were better off with Pavlov.
But you immediately go back to, you know, 25, 30, 40 years ago, and you're pleasant in that experience. Setting because that's exactly what it smelled like when we walked into Grandma's house on Christmas morning.
Right.
You know, those types of bonds in stimulus and response are very, very strong.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it's tough to overcome that stuff, those things through cognitive behavioral therapy.
And the last one is one that I've encountered frequently.
Yeah.
We probably all have, but you might succeed in restructuring somebody's beliefs. They may be convinced, they may say, yes, this is better.
Right.
But if things don't change, if there isn't a change in their behavior, if there isn't a change in their life, if things don't change at all, then the person's simply going to walk away from the process.
Yeah. I mean,
they're doing all this work
to
affect change.
Yeah.
If the change doesn't occur,
you
do that with athletes.
Right.
You know, because in your sports psychology, you know, you can work and work and work with somebody, but if it doesn't translate into increased performance, they're not going to do it.
Right. Yeah, that happened with a team that was That happened to a team that I was working with over the last couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. They went to their first state cup match, and the report that I got back from the coach was not so positive. And so I'm going to be meeting with them again to see how they're going to recover from that. But but we also see this in lots of other things. Like I there's this video that I show to students when I'm teaching this, you know, in a face-to-face class, and it's a video. I'm not sure where it's from. It's from a documentary about OCD, and it's based in the United Kingdom. And what happened is, you know, they're showing this therapist working with a mother who has severe OCD with her for her child over her child's safety and germs and all that kind of stuff. And so one of the things that she does, the therapist does, is exposure therapy. Mm-hmm. And so she has her take her mail, which was a very difficult thing for her because mail is
dirty,
germ ridden. And so she takes the mail and she has her, you know, wiping the mail all over her couch, you know, in sort of this demonstration of spreading germs, and then has her pick up her baby and holding her baby on the couch before it's been cleaned or anything. And the woman is like, you can see her,
the anguish,
really struggling with it. Mm-hmm. And what's, you know, I was thinking that's a fantastic demonstration,
right?
But the thought was, what if the child has a cold the next day? It's over.
Done. You're finished.
It's over. She
may not have anything to do with the sofa.
Nothing at all.
Right.
But if the child has a cold the next day, her symptoms are going to be so reinforced at that point.
You'll never be able
that
to do
she
it again.
She will not recover.
No.
Now, luckily, that didn't happen.
It will confirm her beliefs. Belief.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, and.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. So that I was when I was watching that was my second thought. My first thought was, wow, that's a really great thing that therapists can go into the house and do some of these things with her. Right. Then my second thought was, oh my gosh, I hope that baby doesn't get sick tomorrow.
Well, I think of sports, because I'm thinking that, you know, a person can say, okay, I can do it, I can do it. But if you lose,
right. Well, Brazil in the
that's right.
In the World Cup, last World Cup. They worked with a sports psychologist and worked really hard to do it. Mm-hmm. And then they just fell apart in the semifinals and lost disastrously.
Which was...
sad. Sad.
That was consequential. So there are times when, not because of the clinicians and not because of the process and not because of the approach, it's just too difficult, and it's not going to be effective.
Right.
So what Dr. Minden has done is he's given us an alternative. When we encounter these obstacles, he's given us an alternative, and he's divided it nicely into what your irrational thought, thinking, belief is, and what you can do to overcome it.
Right.
And so he presents an alternative for five different problems.
Right.
Okay. So let's walk through these five.
So the first one is when one of your problems is worrying.
That's
if you believe that you are a chronic worrier and that you're never going to be able to stop it.
Right.
I really like the strategy that he talks about here, because I do this. This is sort of paradoxical. A paradoxical approach, because what he tells his patients to do is, instead of telling them, you know, when you start worrying, you need to recognize that there are problematic negative thoughts and you need to stop it.
That's right.
Instead of saying that, he says, don't do that. Just assign a period of time every day where you worry.
Right. And how you assign that time, or how much time you give yourself, is really up to you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I may choose, if I tend to be more of a worrier than you.
Mm-hmm.
If that's the case, then if I'm working on a project and I start to get these intrusive thoughts about worrying, I may say to myself, I'm going to finish this task and then I'm going to give myself permission to worry.
Right.
Or I might say, I'm not going to do this in the morning. I'm going to wait until after lunch and then I'm going to take some time to go through all my worries, make my list and do all that stuff.
Right.
And I might do that two or three times a day.
Right.
Whereas other people, you know, if you tend not to worry much, you may do it once a day, you know, and that's what he advised. You know, he says, "Well, take 10 or 20 minutes to give yourself permission.
Right.
Instead of fighting against yourself, go with that and give yourself permission to worry." That's the paradoxical
element here. Another sort of twist to it is, if you know that there's a particular activity, a particular time of day where those worries are going to come.
Right.
Take a little bit, assign a little bit of time in front of it to take care of that.
Right.
To go ahead and, you know what, let me worry about this now.
That's right.
So that when I get there, when I have to do it, then I'm okay.
That's right. Because the worry will dissipate.
Right.
Eventually, if you spend enough time worrying, you know, it's going to dissipate eventually. And then you can get back to work.
Right.
Okay? So I like this approach. You're giving yourself, instead of fighting the worry and doing thought stopping, you're saying, okay, this is one of those strong emotions that we talked about earlier. The emotion is so intense that you can't simply get rid of it.
Right.
So don't get rid of it, but structure your schedule around it.
Right. And consider this, you know, if you're listening and you're thinking, oh, well, then, you know, I'm going to try that. We're talking about worries. We're not talking about panic attacks. Right. We're not talking about anxiety attacks or anything like that, because that sort of, you know, you don't want to say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and have a panic attack. Mm-hmm. First of all, that probably isn't going to work. Second of all, you know, that we're talking, with that, you're talking about much more intense emotions and feelings than worrying.
Right.
You know, if I'm worried about, you know, what if I run into this person at the store, or what if, you know, this happens or that happens, those are, especially when they're things that rarely, if ever, happen.
Right.
You know, those are worries that you can take care of ahead of time. You can assign those times for that.
Today's April 14th, right?
As of the day we're recording, yes.
Right. We're recording this on the 14th. Tomorrow's income tax day.
Correct.
At this time of the year, people tend to worry about their finances.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you might be sitting around, whether you did your taxes or you filed for an extension, you might be worried about your finances. You know, this would be a reminder that, oh my gosh, I'm in debt, or I have this to pay and that to pay. Those are worries that you should be able to handle this way.
Right.
They don't lead to panic attacks in most cases, but don't spread the worry out over the whole day. Schedule a time during the day when you want to sit down and worry and fuss about your finances.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So
now the second thing is if you have one of those negative beliefs that you just can't cope with something specific, whether it's fear-based or it's just avoidant-based, that, you know, I just can't deal with fill in the blank. Again, I like this approach because this is what we were talking about with the OCD example just a moment ago, and that is to expose yourself to it very gradually.
Right.
I was talking to somebody the other day, and another therapist, he asked for some sort of some peer review type of ideas, and he was struggling with a patient who has a fear of snakes. And those kinds of phobias are really difficult to manage sometimes because, you know, how often are we really encountering snakes? Certainly it depends on where you live, but you know, if you're living in the middle of town or something like that, it's probably a pretty low probability that you're going to run into a snake. But anyways, if you want to work through that problem, then you work through it very gradually. So you may start out looking at pictures of snakes, then you may look at, you know, toy snakes, and then you may go to, you know, videos of snakes, so snakes actually moving. Because that is something that's usually very creepy for people who have phobias of snakes. And so you work your way through some of that stuff, that gradual exposure.
Right.
But whatever the specific phobia that you have, the specific avoidance behavior that you have, just expose yourself to it very gradually so that you can overcome that.
That's
piece at a time.
And you notice that just in these first two, this one about having fears that you're doing something.
Right.
And the other one, you were doing something.
Right.
What this psychologist is advocating is, rather than just changing your thinking, he's saying, take action.
Right.
Do.
And right.
The verb
do
here
something.
Is do something.
Right.
To get over it. So instead of restructuring your thinking, you're actually doing something to change your thinking.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So I love this approach.
Yeah. Now the third
thing is
if you are frustrated about things because you are a procrastinator.
Right.
I'm glad that you mentioned that, because we should have mentioned that at the beginning, that all of these are actions.
Right.
And so if you feel, you know, I'm a procrastinator, I can never get anything done, then the action that you're going to take is you're going to just do a little bit at a time.
Right.
This happens with students especially all the time.
Yeah.
They think, I have this huge project. Oh, I don't want to do it. So they put it off and put it off and put it off. Instead, say, oh, I have this huge project. I'm going to have an outline done by this weekend.
Right.
And then I'm going to have chapter one written by the next weekend. Right. Mm-hmm. And they're breaking it into pieces instead of trying to thinking about doing the whole thing, because that's what's overwhelming.
That's right. If you define yourself as a procrastinator, and we see this all the time with our students, mm-hmm. we see it with patients, we see it with our own children. Mm-hmm. When people say, well, I'm just a procrastinator. I can't get started. I just do. Mm-hmm. We understand you're a procrastinator. But here's a way to get around that.
Yeah.
Take some little piece mm-hmm. and get it done.
Right.
If you accomplish one little task, it's a little more difficult to define yourself as a procrastinator because now you're doing something.
Right.
And as you say, divide it into small enough pieces so you start to accomplish things, then you can't define yourself as a person who can't get started.
Right.
Because in fact, you're starting.
Right.
So this is, it's incongruous. Mm-hmm. Your action is incongruous with your belief.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, like I have a couple of students who miss school because of health reasons and stuff mm-hmm. like that. And so they end up with a stack of makeup work.
Yeah.
And so they sit down at the table and it's like, no, it's don't do this. They take it, they sit down and they have this stack of papers sitting there. You think, don't do that.
Right.
Take that stack of papers and put them somewhere else and just mm-hmm. put two pages
take
right
one
here.
At a time out.
And just see, okay, now I can do this one and
let
I can do this one.
Let me just get this one finished.
That's all.
Yeah. Right.
Don't have that whole stack there.
Right. That's right.
So, yeah.
Okay.
And then, the next one is, you know, if some of those negative thoughts have to do with feeling victimized, feeling as though other people mm-hmm. are taking advantage of you and that you're being disrespected. Mm-hmm. And again, we're going to talk about taking action. So you want to recognize what some of your behaviors are. What are the things that you're doing that they're taking advantage of?
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then do something about that.
That's right. Because what happens is when we feel people are doing it, we get angry.
Right.
Okay. So this is, how do I deal with anger?
Mm-hmm.
Well, one way to deal with anger is to take action mm-hmm. that is not going to create those problems. Like you say, what are you doing?
Right.
That's creating the problem.
Right.
Okay. Do something else.
Right.
Okay. Put your positive side out there. Let people respond to that, and you dissipate your anger.
Right.
And if you're doing positive things, it's pretty hard for people to be critical and then for you to respond by being angry.
Yeah. Yeah. So I have talked to people before about, you know, if you feel as though people are talking about you or people are sort of going against you or saying things against you, you know, first off, we need to think about the fact that that's your perception.
They probably,
it may not be happening. We don't know.
People don't spend a lot of time thinking about us.
Right. You know? And if they are, it's probably not just you. They're probably like that with everybody else too. Mm-hmm. So it's not always about us.
Right.
Sometimes it's about just them, you know, who they are. It's not you, it's me, that type of thing. But at the same time, if you feel as though somebody is disrespecting you, then you want to step back and think, okay, well, why am I allowing that to bother me?
Right. That's point number one.
Yeah.
You know what? You know,
who cares what that person thinks?
Exactly. Because you can move your entire life to a new place.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, I can't do anything about that.
Right.
When somebody's being critical of me, and we tell our kids this mm-hmm. all the time, sweetie, there's nothing you can do about that.
Yeah.
She's going to say whatever she wants.
Right.
You can't stop her. You can't control it. Doesn't matter whether it's on Facebook, Instagram, or mm-hmm. Snapchat. There isn't a thing you can do about it.
Right.
We say that all the time to our children.
Speaking of that, there's nothing I can do about the fact that there's a guy outside the front door that is blowing
that's
the leaves.
Right. Today's
and
yard
so
day.
Now everybody can hear. I'm sure that people can hear that. We don't get mad about that because there's nothing we can do about that.
You know, I discovered that I
left.
Didn't know that
See?
Those things.
Talking about it made him leave.
When I first moved to Florida.
Oh, he's trying to come back.
Long time ago.
That was a long time ago.
In the 80s. Late 80s.
Okay.
All right. Moved to Florida in the 80s, moved into an apartment building. And one of the first mornings I was there, first or second week, I heard this noise outside.
Mm-hmm.
And it was one of those.
Yeah.
And I had never encountered one of those before. Mm-hmm. I didn't know that leaf blowers existed. Because I lived up north and people didn't do this.
They have leaves up north?
They didn't have leaf blowers.
What did you do?
We raked leaves.
Oh, because you guys lived.
Or
in
other
territory.
Places I lived, they didn't do yard work the way they do it in Florida because they don't have the kind of vegetation that requires this weekly cleanup. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You live in Florida where things grow that grow into your house. You know, plants grow through the floors and walls.
That's true.
And up north, that didn't happen. So you didn't have this massive weekly cleanups. Yeah. And I thought, what in the world is that? It was one of those leaf blowers. Will that record? Did we record a leaf blower this morning?
It may have. It may have been. Maybe.
So if you hear a strange sound, it's a leaf blower outside.
Yeah, it's not.
Okay, it's your.
Nobody's coming in with a chainsaw or anything like that. It's just the leaf blower.
But here we go again. So where we were, so if you hear this buzzing in the background, it's my artificial joints or the leaf blower. So what you have is, what we say is, you can't do anything about this, okay? Mm-hmm. However, if you're concerned about that, these are things you can control.
Right.
So let's figure out what we can do and let's work on those.
Right.
Because if you're working on those, you're going to be less concerned about what people are saying about you.
Right.
Okay.
Now the last one is sort of related to one that we talked about before. At least the strategy is similar to one we talked about before.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, you know, if you have one of those negative, intrusive thoughts that say, why even try?
Mm-hmm.
Things are never going to get any better. This is just the way that it is. This is my lot in life, mm-hmm. as C-3PO would say. And so...
He did.
You know, he... Like, man.
Which...
Never mind. So if you have those kinds of negative thoughts, then again, the idea is to do a little something every day.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to be, and I think that that's something that people sometimes have a hard time appreciating. It doesn't have to be much.
Exactly.
Sometimes just the smallest of things. I was talking real quick, after we did the Make Your Bed podcast today.
Oh, yeah.
I was talking to a patient about that.
Funny story about that. From a listener.
Okay. I was talking to a patient about it, and she says, and at the end of the session, she says, well, what's something that I can do to, you know, like if it's a morning and I can't get up and get going,
mm-hmm.
What's something that I can do to where I can start feeling good about myself? It's like, make your bed.
Right.
Just accomplish one little thing.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Because accomplishing that one little thing is going to give you enough energy to accomplish one more little thing.
Right.
And it just keeps building on itself.
Keep your exercise equipment somewhere in your bedroom.
Yeah.
You know, and on your way to the, lift a few weights.
Yeah.
You know, do something. Mm-hmm. You can do two or three things even before you go to the kitchen.
Yeah.
You know, that make you feel good about your day. But you're right. This fifth one is for dealing with depression.
Right.
You know, we talked about that a couple of times in the past couple of weeks. Dealing with depression because you sort of have these overwhelming thoughts that I'm not competent,
right.
I'm not very good, my life sucks, and you have these recurring negative thoughts. Look at your day and put something fun in there.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't have to be much.
Yeah.
It might be yesterday, for example.
It might be blowing leaves. Because he's back again.
He's back. He's back at the door. I think it's the best. I feel like Little Red Riding Hood.
He's like, what's going on?
Yeah, what are you guys doing in there? But yesterday was a classic example of that. I had to teach in the morning, and we're going over reports. And it was going to be a long, not a difficult day, but it was going to be but my daughter was coming home.
Yeah.
Okay, later in the day. So it doesn't matter what happens, because I get to see my daughter.
Right.
She's away at college.
Right.
And she was coming home for the weekend. And I thought, it doesn't matter. All it took was to think about her being back for a few hours.
Right.
And it changed the whole day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
My entire day changed from one of being tired and knowing that I had a lot of work to do to suddenly
anticipation.
The whole day was different.
Some positive anticipation there. Right.
And for other people, it's, you know, instead of going home and cooking, let's just go out for dinner tonight.
Right.
Let's do something else. And it brightens up your whole day.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, absolutely.
This equipment is brightening up your day, isn't it? One more thing before we leave this.
Yes.
What we've been talking about with these five approaches is doing something that is the opposite of what you're feeling.
Right.
If you're feeling sad, do something that makes you happy. If you're feeling fearful, do something that makes you courageous. You know, take action.
Yeah.
Right. Take action that moves you in the opposite direction. And this concept is used not only in cognitive behavioral therapy, but it's also used in applied behavior analysis.
Sure.
And the idea there, what we teach parents to do is, if your child is doing behavior A,
mm-hmm.
okay, if you teach your child to do behavior B, B is incompatible with A.
Right.
If your child is doing B, she can't be doing A. And Alan Kasdan, who's at the who's at Yale and has written extensively on this topic, calls it the positive opposite.
Right.
Take the negative and then create a positive opposite.
Right.
Because if your child is doing the positive opposite, they can't be doing this negative.
Right.
And that's what really is the foundation of these five approaches,
right.
is that you're doing the positive opposite.
Right.
And that's what we want. That's what we're asking people to do. But instead of just thinking
right.
about, you're actually you're taking action and you're doing the positive opposite.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
I think it's a worthwhile approach.
Yeah.
I think it's something to give some serious thought to.
I agree. So, well, I hope that was helpful. We'll include a link to article in the show notes, so you can check it out. We'd love to hear from you if you have any ideas, if any, you know. If you've tried any of these things and they were especially beneficial or helpful for you, that would be great for us to hear. So, and you know, we'd love to hear from you if you'd write a review on iTunes or send us a message on YouTube. That'd be cool. I've had a chance to write to a few people in the comment section there. I try to always respond. If anybody writes to us on YouTube, I always try to respond. So
respond within 24 hours.
I do my best.
That's what we do.
I do my best.
They have these policies now. Also, since you know what day it is, we know it's Friday, April 14th. And to all of our... This is a holy weekend for Christians.
Oh.
It's a special weekend.
I thought you were going to mention tax day again. You already mentioned tax day.
No, it happens to correspond with the
Good Friday.
It's the holiest of Christian holidays, I'm told. And... So for those of you who are going to be celebrating this holiday this weekend, do it well. Do it thoughtfully.
Find lots of Easter eggs.
Oh, that's right. Candy, too.
Yeah.
Now I was thinking of, you know, when you go through these things, it's a time for reflection as well.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
On your life. And so you try to find some time this weekend, if whether you're Christian or not, try to find some time in the next couple of days to think about your life and how to make it better, what you can do to make it better.
Absolutely.
It's a good time to pause. You know, people are going to be around, family's going to be around. Pause and restructure some things.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Sounds good. So that is it for today. Until next time. Stay happy, stay healthy, and forget to be afraid.